Good morning. The Director of Public Prosecutions in New South Wales has been slammed for allowing the police officer charged over the tasering of great-grandmother Claire Nowlan to video dial into his first court appearance. Nine Sydney Chief Court Reporter Tiff Genders is in Cooma for us this morning. Tiff, what is happening there?
Well, Mark, the magistrate wasn't happy at all. In fact, he said that he was disgusted that he wasn't asked for permission for Christian White to video dial into Cooma local court. Extra security had been organised in anticipation of the police officer's first appearance since the tasering of great-grandmother Claire Nowland at Cooma at a nursing home in May. Now, the senior constable is facing three charges, including recklessly causing grievous bodily harm. It's alleged he urged the dementia patient to stop as she was walking on her walking frame and holding a serrated steak knife before saying the words, "bugger it," as he fired his weapon. The 95-year-old woman died in hospital a week later. Now, there was a solitary protester at court today wearing a big orange sign, and she had travelled from Kiama to Cooma, hundreds of kilometres, to make this statement.
I'm just so, so sorry for them. It's just, it's not something that should happen to anybody. You've got no idea how much this has affected me, because it's just a terrible thing to be done to anybody.
Despite the prosecution agreeing to Christian White to dial into court today, a move was made to force the senior constable to turn up to all future court appearances. That was rejected by the magistrate, and Christian White remains in the community without any bail conditions at all, Mark.
Tiff Genders with the latest from Cooma. Thank you. Well, there's been a mixed reaction from Australians over the Reserve Bank's decision to hit pause on interest rates for now. It was left at 4.1%, but already there are fears it could rise again soon.
Does it worry you? Were you happy to see them on hold?
All the time. We are worried. It's hard, but everyone are there. It is really tough. So yeah. I feel for those who are having to pay extra interest rates. But, yeah, for me, rent's gone up. But
it is definitely painful for the people who have borrowed, and the way it is increasing.
Many economists believe there are still one or two rate rises to come this year. Well, new details on the proposed Indigenous voice to Parliament have just been revealed ahead of a major speech soon by the Minister for Indigenous Australians in Canberra. Live now to Federal Politics reporter Fiona Willen. Fee, what have we learned?
Well, Mark, Linda Burney will today shed new light on what the voice will focus on. So she's giving that speech in Canberra this afternoon, and she's shared a copy of it in advance. And it includes some of her strongest comments to date, outlining the key priorities of the proposed Indigenous advisory body. The minister will say if this year's referendum succeeds and the voice is established, she'll ask it to consider four main priority areas: health, education, jobs and housing. The Prime Minister has expanded on those remarks this morning.
When you've got a life expectancy gap of 8 years, when you're twice as likely to commit suicide if you're an Indigenous Australian, when you're more likely to go to jail than to go to university if you're a young Indigenous male, those are the issues that the voice will concentrate on.
Linda Burney today needs to be honest with the Australian public, not pretend that the voice is one thing when it's much broader than what she's suggesting it is.
Now, the question voters will be asked in the referendum is on whether an Indigenous voice to Parliament should be enshrined in the Constitution. The no side of the debate has repeatedly criticised the plan for lacking detail. And we've seen the government pursued over this in Parliament, with the opposition demanding to know what sorts of issues the voice could advise on and the scope of its powers. Now, with support for the proposal slipping in the opinion polls, it appears the government is now trying to get ahead of those attacks, is moving to clear up any confusion before Australians cast their ballots, most likely in October. Mark?
Fiona Willen in Canberra, thank you. Indonesian President Joko Widodo has wrapped up his three-day visit to Australia. He flew out of Sydney Airport this morning after meeting with the Prime Minister yesterday, touring Taronga Zoo and discussing plans for electric vehicle production. His next stop, Papua New Guinea. A man is in a critical condition after he was struck by a car in Sydney's northwest this morning. The 70-year-old was hit along Castle Hill Road at West Pennant Hills just before 10 o'clock. He was taken to hospital with a serious head injury. The driver was also taken to hospital for mandatory testing. Well, Victoria's building approvals are dropping. The Premier telling media this morning demand has been suppressed by interest rate rises.
I think 12 interest rate rises that have actually happened, as opposed to a modest increase in land tax that came into effect like 3 days ago. I'm pretty sure I know which has had a bigger effect on demand.
The government has flagged a shake-up in coming months to ensure more homes are built. Well, the Princess of Wales has stepped out in a pastel green blazer to take in a match at Wimbledon. Kate was joined by tennis great Roger Federer, who was greeted with a standing ovation. Federer mistakenly breaking royal protocol, greeting her with a pat on the back. A 17-year-old boy accused of being part of a gang that went on a stabbing frenzy along Brisbane's clubbing strip is back in the community today. Andrea Crothers has more.
The 17-year-old was granted bail, but because it occurred in the children's court, it was closed to the media, meaning we can't tell you the reasons why he was allowed to walk free or if he has any criminal history. Police allege the teenager was part of a gang of five masked men who waited before ambushing and stabbing three men in separate incidents as they left Brisbane's nightclubs in the early hours of Sunday morning. One of those men was so horrifically attacked, the knife snapped off inside his abdomen. Police also allege the 17-year-old stole a gold necklace off one of the other victims after he was stabbed. Now he's back in the community. It's understood Queensland police are weighing up their options as whether to appeal the bail decision.
The Brazilian football team has touched down in Brisbane ahead of the World Cup with a tribute to Iran. The plane featuring the words, "No woman should be forced to cover her head, no man should be hanged for saying this," with photos of Masahi Amini and Amir Nasser Azadani. Amini's arrest for not wearing a headscarf and her subsequent death in hospital was a catalyst for the mass protests in Iran last year. Iranian footballer Azadani was arrested during the protests and sentenced to 26 years in prison. At least 15 people have been shot dead in mass shootings over 24 hours across the United States. Three people were killed and another 14 injured after a shooter opened fire into a festival crowd in Texas, one of the victims believed to be a child. And a fifth person has died after a shooting in Philadelphia. Well, King Charles will take part in a second coronation today as celebrations for the monarch switch to Scotland. Europe correspondent Brett McLeod reports from Edinburgh.
The royals are in residence here at Holyrood House, their home in Scotland. And several hours from now, the King and Queen will make their way down Edinburgh's famous Royal Mile towards St Giles Cathedral. It is the second coronation of King Charles. Tradition actually goes back around four centuries, ever since the unification of the Scottish and English crowns. Now, he'll be accompanied by the Prince and Princess of Wales, Kate and William, although, as they're known here in Scotland, the Duke and Duchess of Rothesay. And the King will be presented with the Honours of Scotland, jewellery, crown jewels, which actually are the oldest in the British Isles. It'll be a shorter service than the one that was held at Westminster Cathedral. It will go about an hour, and it symbolises that Scotland too has special recognition when it comes to His Majesty's powers. And at the end of it, there will be another procession back here to Holyrood House and a flypast by the RAF Red Arrows. A special day, a more simple day, but an important one for the end of the coronation services for King Charles.
A burst water main has caused destruction, water spurting from the ground onto a family home in Sydney's West last night. Hayley Francis is at the scene in Seven Hills.
Well, this is the mess the Saxana family are faced with today after a burst water main caused their carport to collapse. Shamika was at home when she thought a storm rolled in over Seven Hills just before six last night. But when she came outside, only her house was in the firing line.
The water was rushing out very forceful, and it was just going on to the roof.
A burst water main sending a jet stream into the air. Ultimately, the pressure was too much for this carport.
The carport, oh my God. For some time it could stand, But then it just came down, it gave up.
Fire crews were here within 15 minutes diverting the burst main. Sydney Water technicians eventually switching off the affected main in order to carry out repair works. Around 140 properties were affected with either no water or low pressure for about 3 hours. The Sixanas are, however, considering themselves lucky their car was not parked at its usual spot underneath the carport.